Welcome, welcome, moth fans. Do you see these dead leaves? Well, you're wrong. They're actually moths pretending to be dead leaves. And in this episode, I'm going to tell you how I raised these guys in captivity. The species is Holocerina angulata, the angled batwing. Let's begin. The story begins here, with very tiny orange and black caterpillars. Ah, so cute. They just freshly hatched from their eggs. I decided to give them ligustrum, also known as privet, but they can also eat robinia and probably a lot more plant species. Not a lot of people dare to go off the beaten path and experiment with new food plants for moths, but rely on following old guides, while in reality they can eat much more plants than we think. Now the caterpillars have grown larger. I kept them in a plastic fauna box. Holocerina moths seem to be relatively easy to breed and raise in captivity. Although I don't think they are a species for beginners, you do need some basic experience with silk moths to raise these, but they are definitely not hard. This species is found in many countries, including but not limited to Ivory Coast, Gabon, Democratic Republic of Congo, Cameroon, the Central African Republic, Tanzania, Uganda and perhaps more countries. Here they feed on ficus, also known as fig, bauhinia, Measia lanceolata, Psorospermum, Pileostigma, Ricinus communis, and presumably a lot more plants. The moth is quite polyphagous and will eat a lot of plants in captivity, so finding food for them should not be a problem. I myself raised several species of Holocerina before, and all of them showed three color forms as caterpillars. Take an old look at this old footage of Holocerina smilax, for example, showing variation in the caterpillars. I have raised several Holocerina species in my life, but in my newbie days, I often forgot to take pictures or videos of my insect. But in this case, I do happen to have an old video of Holocerina smilax caterpillars. Anyways, back to my own species. These Holocerina angulata also showed something similar. My caterpillar showed three distinct forms. The white and black form, the orange form, and the black and yellow form. Having three forms is called trimorphism. And here we see all the caterpillars together. I believe all of them are in the final instar, though some of them are smaller than the others because they're... Well, maybe some of them are males, I don't know. Or some of them are just naturally smaller. They're animals, so you're gonna have variation. But look at that. We see three forms. The striped form, orange form. And we have one unusual one here. That's, he doesn't wanna let go of the stick because this orange specimen here grabbed it, as you can see. But maybe we can show him without disturbing them. You see here this black and white, yellow and black form. This is interesting. We only have one of this color. But as you can see, they clearly have one to three different forms. And this is normal for Holocerina. In fact, I have read multiple species of Holocerina. Sadly, I never took YouTube very seriously until this year, so I didn't film them. But I once had a species from Malawi that had these caterpillars that were white and red, and also orange. And there was also a black form, but that one was really rare. I did only saw one from many. But wow, just look at that, they're so unique. It's such a unique breeding, in my opinion. You don't see this every day. Ah! Oh my God, this really hurts. Guys, I don't know why they hurt so bad. A lot of you are probably wondering how I raised these guys. Well, here's my setup. It's the same setup I use for 90% of my silk moths. Just fill a can or a bottle with water and put a branch of host plant in it. The water will keep the leaves and the plant fresh. And as you can see, the caterpillars are in here. eating from the leaves. And today I have good news, because I found something today. Let's go all the way here in the back to this branch here. Okay, see this? I don't know if you can see it, but here we have the first cocoon. Can you see it? Here, this stuff here, they make very lazy cocoons. And below that, here at my finger, there's a second caterpillar making a cocoon. Whew. Okay, that was difficult to show. I don't want to disturb them too much. Here is a close-up of the cocoons and the cocoon spinning. Can you see it? It's very subtle. They hide between the leaves and they spin them together with silk. Here a nice close-up of the yellow and black form. Do you like it?
I do. I like hairy caterpillars.
The caterpillar should not be touched with bare hands, for they have severely painful sting. You are warned. After about 2 months, the larva started spinning thin cocoons, and then the adults emerged. Last but least, I want to say, don't handle toxic caterpillars like this. It's a very bad idea. I guess I'm trying to be Steve Irwin too much. Even if you think you're a professional, 99 out of 100 times it will be you will be okay. But you just have to be unlucky to develop an allergy or get stung by a caterpillar that you didn't know is deadly. Deadly caterpillars are very, very rare, but they can exist. And I import a lot of species of which nothing is known to science. So by making these videos, I'm really taking a health risk that that's really shouldn't be... You know, don't follow my example. I am stupid and irresponsible. That's important information. Here I have all the caterpillars together in my hand, just for you to show them off. And I hope that soon they will spin cocoons. Now, Holocerina is actually, some of them are easy to breed in captivity. There's really many, many species in Africa. I haven't checked how many, but it's like 30 or 40. I don't know, maybe more. And all of them have really fascinating caterpillars, some of them undescribed to science, and in captivity, some of them really love to eat privet, ligustrum, but also cherry prunus sometimes, even willow salix. Turns out some of these guys are truly very polyphagous, so wow. So fascinating. So painful. Anyways, I'm gonna take them back inside, because it's a little bit cold outside, you know, it's autumn, it's not tropical, it's the Netherlands, it's cold. So let's go back. Here is a close-up of the cocoons and the cocoon spinning. Can you see it? It's very subtle. They hide between the leaves and they spin them together with silk. Clearly in this cage there are no caterpillars left, because all of them have spun cocoons. So here we have a cocoon. See? Gotta be careful, because there's still a pupating larva in it. So let's just snap over the branch. So this is the pupa and the cocoon. Well, of what used to be the cocoon. Pupa is brown and rust colored. And here we have some of the first pupa. This is nine pupa. As you can see, the pupa are a little bit rusty brown. And I'm guessing the small ones are the males and these big ones are the females. I have no clue how long it will take for them to hatch. It could take a month, it could take a year. Hope it will not take a year, but you never know with these moths. It's totally unknown species for me, so first time I've... Well, it's actually the second time I've bred Holocerina. I've read that pupa don't take very long to hatch. I hope this is true. So I would love to see some adults soon. Yep, let's wait. Oh my god. What do I see here? Ignore my messy room, but I was just really walking here into my moth cage. And I happened to notice something. Wow, 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 wow. Do you see this here? This is my first Holocerina moth. Oops. Let's take it for a video. Ah, now here we see our first specimen of Holocerina angulata. In this case a female, just showing you a preliminary, well, what can I call it, a preview before I take the specimens outside in full daylight and film them. Why are my hands getting so dirty? Turns out that these moths produce a gooey brown substance and they secrete it. It's called meconium. If you're wondering why my hands are covered with this, yes, these Holocerina females will make your hands dirty. I'm happy to say that today, yes, finally, males of Holocerina have begun to hatch. Oops. Let's take these guys outside. As you can see, it's cold and misty outside. It's still winter, guys. Sucks, no daylight, no sun. So my video is going to look a little bit depressing, but that mist is also beautiful. I really, really love the Genus Holocerina, and I hope that I will find eggs of other species soon that I can breed and show you on my channel. I really love these guys. There's about 30 species of Holocerina. Well, 30 is maybe too much. I think more like 20. Anyways, there's a lot of them and they are not studied very well. So it would be great to have more of them in captivity. So beautiful, so well camouflaged. It's really cold out here, by the way. This is what I don't like about winter. Luckily, you have me to keep you warm. You have me to keep... Yes, indeed, it is cold outside, but this has one advantage. The cold makes the moths slower, and thus prevents them from flying away, because they are cold-blooded animals, so they become a little bit calm and cool down. Well, there you have it. Holocerina moth. Absolutely beautiful in my opinion. Look how small the males are compared to the female. Pairing these moths can be a little bit tricky because the males only live for a few days because they are so small. They are also very active and will destroy themselves completely in a few days' time by flapping their wings so wildly that they break. And they also lose a lot of their legs. Isn't that fun? So after the males hatch from the cocoons, you have only a few days to pair them with a female. That being said, overall this species is easy to breed, but pairing is the most frustrating thing. After about 2 months, the larvae started spinning thin cocoons, and then the adults emerged. They are pretty impressive looking with their angular wings and camouflage. But when I looked a little bit closer while filming these moths, I saw something very peculiar. A gynandromorph! This is a big rarity. It's very bizarre, and I'm very glad to share this with you on my page. This moth is half male, half female. It's hatched from its cocoon today, a gynandromorph. Can you see the difference? I'm very happy to have this. The chance of getting such a moth is between 1 in 10,000 to 1 in 50,000, although it is hard to estimate. Getting such a moth is like winning the lottery. Females are heterogametic ZW, and maleness can be determined by a single ZW, sex determination system chromosome. So the loss of the W chromosome in one of the daughter cells at the first cleavage event will give one half female and one half male individual. This is the opposite of humans, where males are heterozygous and have XY and females are homozygous and have XX chromosomes. Fun fact, this means that originally Lepidoptera gynandromorphs were always originally female before the mutation happens. That's why this specimen is literally half male, half female. It happened during the very first cell division. When the first cell splits during the first cell division, each of these first two cells will differentiate into the tissues that make up two halves of his body. So this is an aberration, a freak, a male and a female at the same time. For those of you who are interested in the specimen, follow my eBay account. I don't often sell moth specimens, but when I do, they are often special ones like these, and I prefer to preserve them for science or collectors. Thank you so much for watching my video about Holocerina, I appreciate it. Let me know in the comments what kinds of moth you would like to see on my channel in the future. Bye bye!